Wally.
Yes. We are back. We are talking Rock of Ages.
Oh, my God. Why? Because Kevin Nash.
Yeah. He doesn't even do anything.
Zero lines.
The ongoing.
The other big guy spoke a little bit.
Yeah.
He sang.
The other big guy did stuff, too. Kevin was just there.
I guess Kevin just doesn't have that singing voice.
A continuing series of the podcast. Why? Because Kevin Nash.
Yeah. Well, basically, sad about that.
Did you hear my one man show that I put out?
I did. No, I did
never
listen.
You would never listen to that? Well, on there, I talked about how I wanted you to. You will never do this because there's not enough time.
I already did.
You did?
We talked about it last episode.
Nash per minute?
Nash per minute. No. No.
How much Nash?
You talked about that, and I thought, no, I will never do that.
How much Nash per minute of movie? Like a percentage of each each performance.
That'd be pretty funny.
Or some kind of calculation on how much he played a role in the movie.
That would take so much time.
It would take forever.
Especially going back to the
movies.
Such
a waste of goddamn time.
It would be a lot of waste of time, but it would be funny. He's 0.3.
Been a greater waste of time.
Start
giving me the internet money for the show, and I will spend my time doing that.
He's 0.3% involved in this movie.
At least with The Punisher, it's just one scene that you would have to watch, and then it's over.
See, I don't know.
So you have to time each scene, and then
how
do you weigh the value of lines versus no lines?
Oh, there would be an algorithm.
Yeah, you need to come up with some kind of formula.
It's just all right. Much.
Here
too
we
much
go.
For Kevin Nash.
It's 1987. We hear Paradise City is playing on a girl's headset while she's traveling on a bus. She's got that I'm heading to Hollywood to be a star vibe going.
Do we want to even talk about the casting of these jabronis as the leads of this movie?
Well, first,
other than Tom Cruise.
Julianne Hough, right?
Why her? Why?
Because she's good looking and she was hot at the time.
Was she hot at the time?
She was probably coming off Dancing with the Stars. Yeah. You know?
Hot enough to carry a movie hot?
No.
There's been plenty of awful actors and actors.
Oh, of course.
Yeah, I'm not offended by that.
Who's the main guy?
That guy.
He's from a Spanish. I looked him up. He was from a Spanish soap opera.
And he was from Pretty Little Liars.
Yeah, he was.
Diego.
Yes, right.
You want to talk about two fucking duds.
Complete duds.
Absolute duds.
So she starts singing Sister Christian, and the whole bus starts singing.
Oh, when this happened, when everyone started singing,
yeah.
My eyes rolled back into my head, and I could see the back of my
With
skull.
This song, I had a thought, and I was like, I hope this isn't the way the whole movie is. And it's like,
of
course
good singers, so like they can sing, but they're changing this just enough so it's fully just karaoke. They're changing the songs enough that it's not the right version, but they can sing, so it's okay.
We should mention
not everyone's a good singer.
This was a Broadway a Broadway play.
Yeah,
A Vegas show.
No, it was a Broadway play. It was nominated for a Tony.
People liked it.
Well, yeah, sure.
They
but
probably
it
had
actually,
good people singing.
I looked at it, and it was changed significantly.
Yeah.
From the show?
For the Broadway show. I think they made it. I think the show was darker.
Was the show first?
The show was first.
And then this. Okay.
Yeah, the Broadway. This is based off the Broadway show.
Broadway show, yes.
So she gets off the bus singing Just Like Paradise, and she immediately sees a guy get arrested before she starts getting harassed by some hookers and some greasers.
Greasers?
There's 1980s greasers.
Yeah, they were there.
As soon as you step off the bus, it's already the crime of Los Angeles.
We see a barback. He's singing Nothing But a Good Time.
This movie is... Literally, I could groan for two. How long was this movie, too?
2 hours, 14 minutes.
When we get to the end, Tom Cruise has finally written The Song of a Generation, or whatever he calls it.
I almost pooped my pants.
I think I audibly groaned at myself watching this movie.
I almost pooped my pants when The Song of a Generation came on.
I don't even remember what it was.
We'll get that. Sorry.
Well, one song they sing, like, it's like almost like 10 years old at this point. One of this, Don't Stop Believing was released in 1981. And this comes out in 1987. This is supposedly 1987.
And Don't Stop Believing is the song of a decade.
Yeah, it's the song of a lifetime or whatever Tom Cruise is searching for.
Yeah. song that came out literally like right, kind of like right at the edge end of disco. It is kind of disco-y.
I like how he went on a drug bender.
We'll get into it. Yeah. We'll get into the awful.
Okay, so we go to a bar. It's called the Bourbon Room. And we see,
supposed to be the Whiskey Go-Go.
We see Alec Baldwin trying to sing.
Oh, my God. Oh, let me just say, the only good thing Alec Baldwin's ever done, ever.
30 Rock.
Is 30 Rock.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah. That one movie is supposed to be good. I've never seen it, though.
The Hunt for Red October is not good?
The one where he's the car seller?
What, it's got a weird name.
He's fine in like
what about The Departed?
Yeah, Departed, but still in The Departed, I feel like he's the weakest link because he's putting on a very bad Boston accent.
Yeah. Is he in that movie? Oh, he's the captain,
he's like the captain.
He's the cat. He like, you know who works under him? No.
Wahlberg and him work together, right?
And him work together, but I feel like he's part of a different unit that is trying to like tap shit.
Yeah. Because Wahlberg works with
Martin Sheen.
Martin Sheen, yeah. Right. He's in it, though, and he has some funny lines, like, it's a lot of where you pocket high, you wicked fucker.
Like,
I've never seen it, but isn't Glengarry Glen Ross supposed to be good?
That's it.
Yeah.
Right, okay. Yeah.
That's it, though, and I've never seen it. So as far as I'm concerned, he's never done anything good.
No.
30 Rock, I don't even that much.
30 Rock is fantastic.
30 is not fantastic. It's overrated.
No.
All right, so.
Well, when I saw him, I was just like, oh. Just so out of place. Yeah, he's just like a sore thumb.
They needed a comedic element.
Ugh. Oh, because they didn't have Russell Brand?
Who's Russell Brand? Funny? He's in this movie.
Who thinks he's funny anymore?
He fits in this movie, at least.
Who ever thought he was funny?
I mean, Russell Brand was all right.
He was perfect in the role in Forgetting Sarah Marshall.
When he was supporting player, he was fine.
Yeah. All right. Anyways, so Alec Baldwin's trying to sing. We see a waitress getting harassed, but... by some customers, so Drew the bar back, goes to her, and she decides to quit. Then we see Sherry, the bus girl, gets mugged by a rocker guy, and Drew comes over to help her, but the guy gets away.
And they fall immediately in love.
Yep.
No.
30
and
seconds.
And he doesn't help. He's like, oh, that sucks.
Yeah. So make a little small talk. He tells her he might be able to get her a job, but she can't tell Dennis that she's a singer. Dennis is Alec Baldwin.
A job and a boyfriend within 30 seconds.
30 seconds. Yep.
Getting off the bus.
Off the bus. Is harassed, sexually harassed, mugged, boyfriend, job.
Yep.
1 minute within LA.
That LA dream.
This movie's 2 hours long. Like, what the fuck?
All of that stuff happens and is longer than what Kevin Nash does in this movie.
Yeah.
that 1 minute longer.
She meets Dennis, who is Alec Baldwin, and he basically looks her up and down.
Dennis.
He tells her her entire life story, but she convinces him to hire her anyways because the other girl just quit.
I read that Alec Baldwin, like...
he must have gotten $1 million.
He renounced this movie because it was so bad.
It's awful.
Then we cut to a press conference for a mayoral race. And
why is this even in it? Yeah. It's just like
this. I don't think was a part of the play. This whole thing.
It's so dumb.
With Catherine Zeta-Jones.
Yeah,
and Bryan Cranston.
Bryan Cranston. What? Like Bryan Cranston must have got a big fat check.
Got that check. Yeah. Keep getting those checks.
Because he just sat there and like
he
did nothing.
Fondled a hot lady.
Yeah,
he fondled his assistant. At some point, I was like, oh, are they going to make Bryan Cranston sing? Nope.
Oh,
maybe it was cut, but.
So Bryan Cranston's Mayor Whitmore, and he's going to clean up the city thanks to his wife. She thinks rock and roll is a disease. And then we go to Dennis and Russell Brand are talking about her, and they both think that she's stupid.
Russell Brand is insufferable.
Did he have a name?
Is it not Russell Brand?
We're going to go with Russell Brand.
What was his name? I'm sure I could find it out, but I don't want to put
that. Does it matter?
I could Google it right now, but I'm not going to.
He put less effort than if I Googled his name with that thing.
We go to Drew and Sherry at a record store, and they have the same taste in music, obviously.
Duh.
He starts singing.
And they're like, you like a baby fucker, the band? Oh, yeah, I do.
You know what the worst?
It's all shitty, weird bands.
You know what the worst part of being mugged was? They stole my record collection.
Oh, why would you bring your fucking record collection with you?
She literally got on the phone.
Not my money or my license or my passports. My record collection.
Clothes.
She
has clothes. Just a suitcase full of
records.
That's
right.
Yep.
That was the worst thing. Her
that
record
was
collection.
Awful. Yeah.
So Drew starts singing Jukebox Hero, and it's intercut with Dennis and Russell Brand singing I Love like Rock and Roll.
They are so bad.
When I sent you guys a text right when Alec Baldwin started singing, and I was sitting at work watching, and I wanted to rip the monitor off my cube and throw it out the window.
Sherry, and little did you know that would be the better of the two songs that he had sing.
Sherry is very into Drew, and she starts singing with him. He should have kissed her, but he didn't, cliche. Then he tells her that he gets stage fright, so he can only be a jukebox singer.
Which never comes up
again.
Again?
No, he plays. He's
a superstar.
He plays in front of everybody, and he's just.
No issues.
Nope, he loves it.
No issues.
He's great.
He's so angry.
She tells him the key is breathing, and he asks her out immediately. She says yes. And then we get the awkward hug, face mash, kiss thing. We see Mayor.
Genuine love and affection.
Mayor and Mrs. Whitmore talk about shutting down the bourbon room. And then we go to Dennis, who hates taxes, and it seems money is really tight, and they have to rely on a super unreliable rocker to show up to their bar for his next show. So Dennis decides to call Stacy's manager.
No one is perfectly cast in this movie as this. Pig Vomit.
Yeah.
Pig Vomit being in this role, which is great.
He's pretty much playing Pig Vomit.
Yeah, right.
Stacy Jax is played by Tom Cruise.
Also, Tom Cruise is great.
I love Tom Cruise. I love most of his movies. I thought he was terrible. I thought this was terribly miscast. I thought... Like, I get it. If you get Tom Cruise in this, like, you get him.
Okay. But he is miscast.
Because, like,
he's not a sexual object.
Yeah. And, like,
but
like, I guess.
Sometimes that brings some of the best Tom Cruise. Like, when he's supposed to be a tough guy in Jack Reacher, and it's so unbelievably not real.
He should have been Alec Baldwin's character, and they should have gotten some other person to be.
The thing is like, I guess he's trying to be Axl Rose and, I guess, Slash at the same time. But still, like, he just doesn't. Tom Cruise, even when all done up, I just don't believe him as a rock and roll star with tattoos.
Absolutely not.
And he went through, like, he went through 3 months of singing training. That is him singing.
It sounded like him, and it didn't sound, I mean, it wasn't good, but.
Well, he does all the, his own stunts,
it was serviceable.
Sing.
Yeah.
So
he hung off a fucking plane.
Yeah, that's pretty.
Just keep hanging off planes, dude.
All right, so Dennis calls Stacy's manager, Paul, who is Paul Giamatti. His name in the movie is also Paul.
Mm-hmm. Naturally.
Of course.
And they are still on for Friday. And then Paul pretends he's talking to Stacy when he's really looking at Kevin Nash.
There he is. He's gone.
Gets off the phone, and he goes straight into Stacy's dressing room, which has a lot of strange shit going on. And Stacy is in.
Can we talk about these these tropes of, like, weird guy has to have a monkey? Like, does he, though?
It's just, like, it's just every
does he, though?
Stupid, like, cliche of, like, a rock star.
In the
80s. Yeah.
Yep.
Just the monkey alone. It's just.
Like, why does he need a monkey? Why?
You mean Hey Man?
Hey Man.
Yeah.
Hey Man.
That joke isn't funny either.
Yeah, no.
You couldn't have come up with anything better than that.
And this monkey was prominently
very important.
Important in this movie.
Yeah.
This monkey very important. Super maybe more so than Russell Brand and Alec Baldwin. And they're all awful storyline.
Oh God.
So we see Stacy in bed with three women, and then he stands up and he's in assless chaps and is completely hammered.
Whoa, dude.
Paul tries to get him to go on stage, and he immediately falls in a pool.
Is there a pool? Oh, who knows?
Because I thought this was his dressing
room. He's having sex, but he's in assless chaps.
Right. And he
I don't understand that either.
We go to Mrs. Whitmore is giving a hate-filled speech about Stacy to a bunch of Christian ladies who also hate him.
And you knew right away, like, they know each other.
Immediately. Yeah. Yep.
Mayor and his assistant leave the church. Mrs. Whitmore and her friends start singing, "Hit Me With Your Best Shot."
This might be the worst part of the movie.
The thing is,
the worst song of the movie.
And it's also intercut with the mayor and his assistant having a little BDSM fun.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. The thing is like, these are all radio jukebox. I don't know what the word is, like that.
Pop hits.
Yeah.
Radio 80s hits. And there's nothing more I loathe now than the radio.
It's awful.
I hate the radio. And I really think people who listen to the radio are kind of like, they're kind of insane. I don't understand it.
It's why
I feel like you're insane.
What I don't get, like radio, you mean talk radio?
No.
Is that what you're saying?
Radio. I listen to talk and music radio.
People who listen to music radio, FM radio, I feel like
the reason that I enjoy radio is because it's the only place I can get like that. Oh, surprise! I have
a surprise of what?
If I'm just playing my own music, it's the same music over and over and over.
But you could put like 1,000 songs on your phone.
I know.
Like radio stations play the same 50 songs.
Yeah, but that's
why do they ever? Yeah, I worked in one for a long time. Yeah. I heard Katy Perry "Firework."
Oh,
more times than I could count in one day.
Classic rock is just the worst. Like,
yeah,
it's the same 9 songs. I can't stand AC/DC anymore because I've heard AC/DC shoved down my throat, the same 5 AC/DC songs, and Led Zeppelin, they're all the same. Now, I'll give like alternative like EQX, and there's like 2 new ones around here at least that aren't bad.
Even so, some of those new ones aren't as good as you think.
The classic people who run the classic rock radio stations should be thrown in jail. And you who listen to it, like, I will never understand.
Because the other thing with the radio is, I don't listen to one station. I listen to like 12 of them, and I flip until I find something.
Like, I'd understand a serial killer before I understand someone who listens to FM radio every day.
He's calling you.
I know.
Some very bad things.
My significant other does the same thing, and I don't understand it.
It's nice to be surprised by a song.
Awesome. Okay.
If it's my playlist, I can't be surprised because I'm the one who picked it.
I guess.
All right, so then we go to Drew, who clocks in, and he runs into Chico, who says he has to work tomorrow night. That's the whole scene.
Who's Chico?
Exactly. Like, he's that got fat two
Mexican guy who's just kind of.
Oh, that's right. That's right. He was the guy. Yes.
Then we see Drew and Sherry in the bathrooms. They're singing "Waiting for a Girl Like You," and then they meet outside, and she hops on his Vespa, and they go.
Of course, he has a Vespa too.
They go to the Hollywood sign and hang out.
God, you go to the Hollywood sign.
In one of the O's, and they talk about their families.
They hang out in the Hollywood sign.
His family was super discouraging, and hers was very encouraging.
But they're all dead, right?
Her grandma's still
get
alive.
Out of here.
Yeah,
get out of Iowa or whatever she's from.
Yeah, where was she
Oklahoma.
From?
Oklahoma, I think.
Oh, right, because she wanted to go back to Tulsa.
Yeah,
she got bought a ticket to Tulsa.
So then Drew imagines Sherry doing a sexy dance.
Because it's her who dances.
Yep.
She turns into no sense.
But he doesn't want to see her sing. He wants to see her strip.
Yeah. And,
they sing "Waiting for a Girl Like You" again, and then they kiss.
Ooh.
She forces him to grab his guitar and sing while she points a spotlight at him from in front of the Hollywood sign. He sings a little bit of "Don't Stop Believing," saying he wrote it after meeting her last night.
That's right. That's right.
God.
That's right. It's so...
Oh my God!
Do they mention Journey in this movie?
No.
I feel like I was listening to a podcast where they talk about Journey.
Okay, so she sings it, and he tells her it sounds better because she's amazing. And then there's a happy montage of them together. Dennis gets off the phone, and the opener just canceled for Stacy's show.
Of course.
Why would they?
Of course. Sherry.
Why would you cancel
the greatest show ever?
Starting in front of Guns N' Roses.
Yeah.
Sherry tries to get Drew to do it and convinces Dennis to let him do it. Dennis tells Drew to call his band, so Drew just yells to pretty much everybody else who's working there.
We didn't even talk about the fact that I hate that he's called Dennis, too. Dennis, awesome rock guy. He's like, you can't sing or perform if you want to be a part of the bar.
Yeah.
So she has to like pretend that she doesn't sing, and so does he. But so does everyone else.
Yep.
Yeah.
You
can't work at a bar unless you're also a musician, I think is the rule.
Apparently that's what it is.
So Drew looks at Sherry and he's about to tell her he loves her, but she stops him.
Loves her? It's been 4 minutes.
Yep. It's literally been 24 hours?
For 3 minutes and 50 seconds. At first sight.
The other waitress comes out of nowhere and she tells Sherry that she'll go invisible once the spotlight hits him. And
yep.
Sherry sings "More Than Words."
Oh.
That's a bad song.
Russell Brand does some weird shit to prep the mic for the band.
I did kind of enjoy the fact that he was weird microphone guy, because there are a lot of weird microphone guys out there.
I'm sure you know them better than us.
Like, when he was like, "What is your band's name?" That's terrible. It's not any better.
That was funny, because that's kind of how sound people are. They're kind of just like, every band ever sucks.
All right, so Drew immediately knocks the mic over and is clearly nervous, and there's nobody in front of them, so there's a stage fright. Russell tells him some decent advice about trying to get over a stage fright. Picture yourself completely alone with something that you love. Drew then starts to sing Heaven as Sherry sings it outside. We see a white limo pull up in the alley as Stacy and a monkey in a leather jacket get out.
God. I mean, Hey Man.
Hey Man, the baboon. Dennis.
That would completely rip your face off.
Yeah.
Yeah.
An animal. Absolutely.
Yep. Dennis and Paul chat a little bit before Stacy and Hey Man walk in.
I want you to
rest. Stacy is a weird guy and talks about burning the place to the ground. Dennis can't tell if he's joking or not. And then Stacy goes to his dressing room, and Sherry faints when she sees him. Drew helps her up, and they share a moment. And then a Rolling Stone writer comes to do...
This was brutal. This part was brutal.
Yeah. Alan Ackerman.
Who's way better than this. She's so good in Children's Hospital.
She was in Watchmen, Children's Hospital.
The movie, not the HBO show.
There's something else, too, that I recognized her from.
Yeah.
Like a weird Vince Vaughn movie.
Once you saw her, you're
like, on vacation, it was probably on TBS.
You're like, oh, God.
Then it's probably where I saw it.
So she comes in with Paul, who tries to wake Stacy up for the interview. Stacy asks where Mick is, and Paul tells him it's the magazine. Oh, he was asking for a different interviewer. Okay.
Because he says Rolling Stone, so he's like, oh, where's Mick?
Oh, right. That's it.
Yeah, Mick Jagger.
Get it.
A groupie runs in and has him...
They exist in this movie, but Journey doesn't.
Has him sign her breast before Kevin Nash carries her out. That's the second time we see him. Stacy gives the interview only 5 minutes, and he's a complete dick to her. She tells him people have been calling him difficult to work with, and it was his own band who said it. She asks him if he was forced to go solo because everyone hates him. He still doesn't really talk to her. She starts going through his biography, and he starts stonewalling her, especially when she brings up his high school ex. She basically tells him he's been over for a while now, and he tells her that time's up.
He's been over for a while, but he has a sold out show.
Yeah.
And people faint in his presence, but he's over.
Yeah. She asks him what it's like to be the Stacy Jacks, and he sings Wanted Dead or Alive.
This is a brutal...
Although I will say, this movie is the first time I actually listened to the lyrics of that song.
It's a rough one.
I paid attention to them on the radio.
So he goes through a fantasy of singing to a packed stadium, and when he comes out of it, Sherry sings with him, and he notices her, and he introduces himself to her. She's completely starstruck, so he just grabs her tit, and she lets him. He asks her to bring a bottle of scotch to his dressing room, so she goes back and talks to Drew for a second, but is too flustered about Stacy, and Drew can tell that that's no good. And then we see Mrs. Whitmore on the news trying to shut down the bourbon room. She's right outside.
Yeah. Oh, we get Will Forte.
Who's in this movie literally just to be like, what do you think?
Yeah.
Hey, what do you think, kids?
That's
all he does.
Russell Brand sneaks into the shot, and he grabs the mic and does more Russell Brand things. The reporter talks Malin Eckerman talks more straight shit about how crappy Stacy has gotten. She calls out Paul especially, and she blames it on him.
It's always the manager's fault that you're addicted to drugs and alcohol.
Yeah.
Stacy tells everybody to get out, including Paul, except for Malin Eckerman.
Oh, my God.
He tells her that he rejects sex because that's what everyone expects from him, but he really wants to find love, but he's a slave to rock and roll. She keeps backing away from him, but he keeps getting closer.
That's going
to
be on my headstone one day.
And then she definitely wants...
Just a slave to rock and roll. That's why this happened.
She definitely wants to have sex with him. But
what is sex in this world? Dance sex? Where you don't
dance sex?
Yeah,
you never take off your clothes. You just hump the air in close proximity to each other.
He walks away from her, and he sings, "I want to know what love is," and she joins
in. This movie is literally considered like one of the worst
shit
songs of the 80s. A song that killed.
Oh, I want to know what love is?
Yes, because it was Foreigner. Yeah. And Foreigner was a rock band who did Jukebox Hero.
Yeah.
Then they switched to this song.
The pops to try to.
And I think it was because they something with like the bandmates. But this song is considered like a it's a terrible song.
It is a terrible song.
And then they do sing the worst song of all time. We Built This City.
We Built This City on rock and roll.
It is considered like the worst song of all time.
We do get that later.
Yes.
Yeah. So Stacy's not really paying attention to her as she starts to undress him, and then we see Drew, who's looking for Sherry, but he can't find her, which is foreshadowing. Oh, mistake. Reporter and Stacy gonna fuck. Sherry is getting damn scotch fuck from the limo.
Because there's no scotch at the bar.
In the bar.
In a rock bar, there's no scotch.
I don't know. The reporter starts.
This guy doesn't have a rider? Like, you get scotch backstage.
Oh. The reporter.
He's already gone through it.
Everyone's over him.
He's already gone through it all.
Just grabs
he's
his
over
clothes.
He's over. He has no popularity anymore.
She grabs her clothes and leaves. Sherry sees her but brings in the scotch. She drops it and it breaks. It gets on her and
her dress falls off slightly.
Off, yeah.
And he fixes it for her.
Yep. Then we cut to Russell on stage, who's introducing Drew and his band. Right before Drew walks out, he sees Sherry, who's leaving Stacy's dressing room, and she starts fixing her shirt, and Stacy's playing with his dick in his pants.
Wait, so right, no, they
had
didn't
just
Sherry and Stacy did
nothing.
But they almost do later on. Right?
Later on.
I was like, did that happen back to back? They sexually assaulted two women?
Sex dance, two women?
Drew eventually goes on stage. He looks at his band and he yells, "I Wanna Rock." And then goes right into "I Wanna Rock."
That is a good song. Literally, not this version of it.
Literally, it's like so angry. He then sings like, "I Wanna Rock."
Yeah.
He
gets over his stage fright.
There are no angry songs written in the 80s.
No angry songs.
That's as angry as it gets in the 80s.
The crowd slowly gets into it, but then they start loving it.
I just want to rock, but I can't.
Drew seems to be motivated by being pissed off. Paul likes what he's seeing from the band.
But not really, because he just turns him into a boy band. Like,
yeah.
Which is like 25 years too early.
Likes what he's seeing. Yeah.
But New Kids on the Block.
Yeah,
okay, so. Yeah.
89, right?
I guess maybe it's okay.
Drew walks away from Sherry after he gets off stage, and she doesn't understand why, so she follows him outside. He doesn't tell her why he's mad.
Typical.
He just
typical man.
Blows up at her and tells her that she's nothing to him.
Mm-hmm. Whew.
She quits, and he tries to follow her, but Paul stops him and convinces him that heartbreak is the key to fame.
The breakup is like they've been together for 20 years. In reality, they've been together for three minutes. It's all been like two days.
2 days.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe we'll say maybe three.
Okay,
maybe
3 days.
Stacy is on stage, and he's singing "Pour Some Sugar on Me."
Of course, yes.
Drew,
such an awful song. A truly horrid song.
Drew tells Dennis that both he and Sherry quit. Dennis doesn't care because the place is going crazy and it looks like he's going to be all set with money.
But no.
We see the reporter in the crowd, but then she leaves. Drew tells Drew tells Paul that they have a deal. And then we go to Dennis and Russell after show, who brought in $31,000.
That's it.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like that much for the show of the century.
That's it.
Yeah, through. Like, man. Just at the bar, you should have made probably double that.
And like I was thinking of like prices. Like if this is Guns N' Roses at their peak, there's no way you can afford them.
But it's not. It's like at the tail end of them being.
Maybe.
Because he's about to go solo.
Okay.
So Paul walks in and he tells them that Stacy is due exactly $31,000 for the show, and they thought it was a free show and it's going to kill the bar. The non-Kevin Nash bodyguard takes the money.
Mm-hmm. Kevin Nash doesn't even get to take the money.
Nope. Sherry sings "Hard in My Heart." We see a montage of her in sad ways. She's in the rain and finds a picture of her and Drew before ripping it up.
And Mary J. Blige notices her on the ground.
Why Mary J. Blige is in this movie.
And comes out with an umbrella and brings her back to her strip
club. What's her name? Justice?
Oh, I have no idea. I just call her Mary J.
Justice?
Something like that. Sure. I... Like, what are you doing?
This girl...
Why are you in this
movie? It is. It's 2 days.
Yeah.
I can only be a stripper now.
Yep. Now, immediately.
As a stripper.
Immediately. So Sherry says she needs a job, but Mary...
Also, this movie hired a dancer to play a singer.
Yeah.
So I don't know what the hell is going on.
I'm sure she was trying to be... You're not just a
dancer.
Yeah,
she's definitely trying to break into
this. When it comes to Hollywood, you're everything.
Yeah.
I guess, but... That's what she's supposed to be known for, and she dances a lot in this movie.
So,
play to your strengths.
Sherry says she needs a job, but Mary J. kind of shrugs her off. But, of course, Sherry convinces her easily that she can do it. But she's not going to be a dancer. She's going to be a waitress.
Okay.
Mary J. sings Shadows of the Night while strippers dance, and Sherry sings some more of Heart in My Heart. Sherry gets her ass grabbed and throws a drink in the guy's face. Then we go to... The mayor and the wife.
Oh, right. Those people. Still who, doing.
Oh, yeah. That
still
side.
In the movie.
That side plot.
Plot D.
That who doesn't matter.
I think at this point.
You, what is it? You've entrapped my heart or something like that?
I have no idea what I'm talking
What's
about.
What's that from? Workaholics. When they're all mushroomed out. Yeah.
So they're in their limo, I think, and they've got dirt on the bourbon room for not paying their taxes. He asks his wife about her obsession with Stacy. She tells him in very vivid detail about her undergrad roommate who got seduced by Stacy at the Bourbon Room. But it's definitely
It's her.
Then we go to Drew, who's writing about his breakup and recording and singing Here I Go Again, intercut with Sherry at the strip club and looking for other work and singing as well. Russell tries to embolden Dennis about the state of the Bourbon Room and then sings Can't Fight This Feeling as they both
profess
where did this come from?
What a love story.
As they both profess their love for each other.
When
and kiss at the end of the song.
Okay, in the first song that they sang, I had this weird feeling. I'm like, are they together? I don't know why.
Really?
Yeah, there was like a weird look
between the two of them, and I'm like,
good for you guys. You obviously got it.
Are they together? This is a weird pairing.
About to be.
Yeah.
And they are.
I was just like, what the fuck is this?
This scene is so bad.
Yep. So they sang.
So forced and all.
Can't fight this feeling.
Like, yeah, like two people with zero chemistry. Zero,
zero interest in kissing each other.
Yeah. Is Russell Brand actually a singer or was he a comedian?
He was a radio host. Okay. I think he sings too.
Okay. Then we go to Sherry and Mary J. talking about how she needs to start working on the stage and being a star up there. Mary J. sings Any Way You Want It. Then we see Paul and Drew going into board meetings trying to get a record deal, but nobody wants anything to do with them. Sherry starts dancing instead of being a waitress, and Drew and his band are recording a pop music video instead because he's sold out, but he hates it.
And he's all like...
Paul Giamatti,
the
fucker.
Z crew or
something. Oh, God, yeah.
Z-Boys.
Z-Boys. So bad. Even bad for trying to be bad.
Yeah. Paul just tries to get him to do it anyways. So he calls up Dennis to try to get them a gig at the Bourbon Room tonight. He tells Dennis that it's Stacy's first solo gig with a brand new act. So they agree that the Bourbon Room gets all the money this time. Paul goes to his assistant and
Why would they trust this fucking guy?
Yeah.
Well, actually, they do. Him and Russell do... Say, do we trust him? Should we do it? So at least they covered themselves a little bit.
So he just played a show, 24 hours ago?
No. This is at least a couple weeks because they've gone around.
Weeks ago, he played a show at this place, and he's going to play again.
All right, so Paul goes to his assistant, and he tries to give her some orders, but she just tells him that Stacy's magazine cover hit the stands an hour ago, and he's like, oh, is he on the phone? She says, no, he's waiting in your office. So you know shit's real. Heyman keeps throwing stuff at Paul.
Heyman.
Stacy throws Paul the magazine, which torches both him and Paul. Stacy didn't know that they screwed the Bourbon Room out of the money last time.
Because they're Rock Brothers, him and Alec Baldwin.
Yep. Paul tries to weasel his way out of trouble with Stacy, and Stacy pisses on him and then fires him.
Literally.
He pees on him.
Yep.
Yeah, that was so fucking gross.
As he leaves, we hear a news report that Dennis has to pay back taxes by midnight or he loses the bourbon room.
Because that's how the IRS works, at midnight.
Yep.
Sherry and Drew accidentally meet at the Hollywood sign.
How do you accidentally meet at a sign in the side of a mountain?
Just randomly.
They both try to act like their lives aren't shit. But then he immediately tells her the truth about how his
band is still wearing the boy band getup.
Yeah, wearing this stuff.
He's got to perform.
Where does she live?
The Hollywood sign.
How does she have an apartment? Did she get an apartment?
The stripper money is good. That stripper money is real good.
So she doesn't want to tell him about how bad her life is. So she tells him that she's teaching aerobics. He finally confronts her about sleeping with Stacy, and she tells him that she never did that and that she was in love with him.
That's just literally yesterday?
She's going to move
2 weeks ago.
She's going to move back home. So
already, she's given up.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's been a hard 2 weeks.
We'll say at most 3 weeks.
A lot has happened in that 3 weeks. Yes. She's been mugged. And she got off a bus and got mugged, and she became a stripper within 3 days.
Yep. She then immediately tells him about being a stripper, and he tells her he's in a boy band because they're both embarrassed, and she says that he's got more to be embarrassed about, which,
I'd rather be a stripper than a boy band member.
Yeah. He gives her a tape about the song he was writing about them, and then we get them both singing Every Rose Has Its Thorn, and we see Stacy at his mansion, and he sings it as well, and Mary J. Blige at the strip club. Why not? Let's have her sing it.
Toss her in there. What the
hell? Hey, she's a real singer. Toss her in there.
Stacy walks into the strip club and sees Sherry, and he decides he wants a private dance from her. I don't think he recognizes her at that point,
Believe so.
He's on the pole when she walks in, and he offers her $10,000 to do whatever it seems.
Dance fucking.
Dance sex.
So she agrees, and they dance and sing Rock You Like a Hurricane. They are about to fuck, but she stops because she knows he doesn't want to.
Which he absolutely does. He's paying you $10,000 for it.
But, like, it's not where his
it's
heart
not in his
is.
Heart. It's not in his heart.
It's not his heart that he's just wants thinking to with.
Dance on people.
And then Mary J. gives her a pep talk about love and junk. Drew sends her some records, like, at the perfect time. And it's like they were the records that she lost when she was mugged.
How would he even know?
I think they're the exact ones because they all have... She wrote on them or something.
Oh, he found them.
And he like dug through and found all the ones with stuff written on them.
So Stacy calls Rolling
Stone. What a nice guy.
Rolling Stone, and he wants to talk to Malin Ackerman.
Calls her like Cinderella or something.
Yeah. The guy who answered the phone tells him that she's at the Bourbon Room covering Stacy's first solo gig. Yeah, Weasel from
TJ Miller.
TJ Miller, yeah.
Career went into the toilet.
His little scene is pretty funny though. I enjoyed him. Is this serious?
He's a funny guy, but his life is.
I feel like I'm gonna die.
His life is kind of a mess.
Yeah, that's sad. Paul tells the band to lip sync. Drew doesn't want to do that. And then we go outside to Mrs. Whitmore on the news again, while the mayor and his assistant are having fun somewhere, and the Russell and his rockers are boycotting the boycotters, and they break out into We Built the City, while Mrs. Whitmore and her ladies break out into We're Not Going to Take It. They're on opposite sides of the street.
Just the worst.
And we get the reporter. What's his name?
Will Forte.
Running back and forth.
That's
at
he got
the
paid
exact
to do.
Opposite time of when the people were singing. I'm not a Will Forte guy.
You don't like MacGruber.
He didn't. MacGruber, we watched
fantastic.
It.
That's the only thing
is
okay.
Last Man on Earth or whatever is okay.
That's
okay.
His stuff on SNL is pretty damn good, too.
But MacGruber is phenomenal.
The MacGruber's SNL and the movie.
So, Stacy drives through the two boycotters, and he talks to Mrs. Whitmore while...
On a motorcycle, because Tom Cruise.
No, he's in a...
Is this not the motorcycle part?
We'll say it's whatever. I don't care.
I think it is the motorcycle part.
Sure, it's the motorcycle part. Russell Brand notices something, and he runs to go inside, and he finds an album. Then he runs back outside. Mrs. Whitmore is about to kiss Stacy again because he's so sexy. Mm-hmm. And everyone sees that. And Russell comes out, and shows an album cover, and he flips inside, and there's Mrs. Whitmore in the album for Stacy Jacks' first record.
Yeah.
Yep.
Worst kept secret. Oh, my God. Worst kept secret of the movie.
She actually loved him before. But
so now they've been forgiven of their taxes, and that's fine. And street cleanup is over.
Yep. Stacy walks into the bourbon room and finds the reporter, but he gets stopped by a groupie, even though he's only wanting the reporter, Malin Ackerman. The groupie makes out with him in the weirdest way, even though he keeps
direct eye contact
with her instead of, you know, so stopping
creepy.
That.
So creepy.
Then we go to Russell Brand, who's on stage, and he's introducing Drew's group. And it's Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Except not as good.
Oh,
good vibrations, bro.
And then Dennis recognizes Drew, and he talks to Paul.
I have a hot take. Good Vibrations is a better song than half the songs in this movie.
That is 100% the case. And I like I like the real versions of some of these songs.
Drew sees Sherry in the crowd, and he leaves the stage to kiss her. They make up very easily.
Sure, yeah.
She makes fun of his new band and look. And then we see Dennis tell Drew that he's got to do something, otherwise he's going to lose his club. Stacy's bodyguard gives Dennis the first show's money. Again, not Kevin Nash.
Nope.
Mm.
Stacy and the reporter are destroying the bathroom because they're having crazy sex.
Bathroom dance sex.
Yep. Paul tells Drew that he's over, and then Heyman punches Paul out.
Of course, Heyman. The monkey has to punch him out.
Yep.
Punches him out.
Sherry's up on stage, and
of course it does.
She starts singing Don't Stop Believing, and then Drew gets up there too. Stacy hears the song from the bathroom, and they stop having sex to go listen to it.
That has never happened.
Oh, and then we cut
I better stop this. I better stop this. Have you heard the song?
We cut to a sold-out stadium, and Stacy is singing it with Drew and Sherry.
So he's stolen their song.
Yep.
The
reporter, Malin
Ackerman.
He
found the key to being an artist. You steal other people's music.
Yep. Malin Ackerman is pregnant on the side of the stage. And
God.
She's like 11 months pregnant.
Of course
she's it's
pregnant.
Like a month later.
We see Mrs. Whitmore in the crowd in full rocker gear. She's gone back to her rocker ways.
It was that easy. Just one look into those Tom Cruise eyes.
Terrible movie that you chose.
Just one look into those Cruises.
Worst.
This movie is awful.
Yeah.
It's truly.
You did this on purpose to hurt us.
And it worked.
I honestly didn't think it was going to be that bad.
Oh, come on. You laughed and went, ha ha ha, like an evil villain.
And it was still even worse than that.
You expected to hurt us, and it was worse than you thought.
Yes. Yes, wow. Exactly.
Thank you for that.
Yep. So that was
so at least I can forever remember that scene between Russell Brand
and
Heyman.
And Heyman. All those things. They're going to be burning my brain forever now.
Yep.
This thing only has it should be way lower. It's like a 38% on Rotten Tomatoes.
Yeah, it
should
be zero.
Why is it so high?
I don't know.
This is made for
nostalgia for people who
honestly,
like those songs.
This is made for like
that's, here's the thing.
50-year-old moms.
Some of those things I like. These are terrible versions of the songs.
Yeah. This movie's made for 50-year-old moms.
Yes.
That's
yes,
what
it is.
It's made for.
Why you cast Tom Cruise for those 50-year-old moms.
Of course. And Juliana Huff.
Huff.
Juliana. Would she have a brother, too? Is there a brother?
Yes.
Is that what it is, the brother?
She has a
brother? I was never sure, and I'm not even trying to make a joke. I was never sure if it was a boyfriend or a brother.
Derek.
Or a husband or a brother, I mean.
I think it's a brother.
I think it's a brother.
Okay.
Anyway.
Yep.
Her career really took off after that because she... she didn't do anything.
I thought you were being serious.
I feel like she's doing something on TV again. Yeah. I don't know.
She's probably got stuff to do.
Yeah, she's probably
doing something. Don't worry, she's making plenty of money.
She's fine.
So
all right.
I wonder what that sound bodyguard's up to these days.
Yeah, whatever happened to that guy? Did he ever become a Russian and fight a Punisher?
I don't know the answer to the question.
Did he ever?
I don't know.
Did he ever cut off the back of his suits and fill a briefcase filled with someone else's shit? let's find out. All right. That means it's one of you two guys next.
Oh, shit. I believe it's Mike's turn.
Oh, shit.
I believe.
I have no clue.
Really?
Yeah, no.
Before you went, I did Peanut Butter Falcon, right?
Yes, that does sound
yeah,
right.
Yeah, so you're still
oh, yeah, because you did
I did trivia.
Yep, so it is Mike.
Oh, yeah.
Probably yeah. should have given him a heads up.
Yeah, no, because it's been 2 weeks now.
Yeah. Missed last week because of my flu.
Yeah, give me... I'll try to think of something.
All right, we may or may not watch this movie for next week.
Okay.
All right. We'll just rewatch this.
Yeah, we'll right? talk about this again. We'll talk about this again.
Part two. Look forward to part two. No, please, God.
Yeah.
All right.